Good morning, and a very warm welcome to you all, to those of you here, and to those who are joining us online. It is a really warm day. We're doing what we can with the windows and the doors to keep some air coming through, but I'm sure we'll get there. My name's Ashley, and I'm your service leader today, and it's great to have you all with us, and it's great to have Keith and Senga back as well. Keith is going to be speaking to us this morning, in a little while, and finishing off this series that we've been looking at in 1 Thessalonians, speaking on the subject of living together as God's people. But first, we have the all-important announcements for the week. So here we go. If you have any items for prayer or thanksgiving that you wish to share with us, then please message us. The number should be appearing on screen, 07579025376. We'd love to hear from you. A number of our church family have got COVID-19. Please pray particularly for Vic and Pat London. I understand that Vic is now back out of hospital, so that is great news. Also, the Moffitt, the Hunt and the Spears families, so we just pray for swift recoveries. And there are others that are isolating as well. This coming week is an exciting week for us because we open our doors for the first time to Food Bank. We are going to become a food bank hub starting tomorrow and then again on Friday morning. So please pray for that. It's a new initiative and we're really excited about it. And also, some of us are going to be involved in the Renew Wellbeing Cafe project, which we're launching in September. We have our second training session on Tuesday evening this week at 7:30 p.m. Alan Ashby's funeral will be held here on Wednesday at the 28th, at 11 o'clock on the 28th of July, followed by a committal service at Basingstoke Crematorium for family and invited guests only. There will be light refreshments after the service for those who are not invited to the crematorium. The family and invited guests will have a private wake after the committal at the crematorium. Giving. There should be a slide on screen that tells you all the different ways you can give. Regular donation, Church Suite app, contactless payment machine at the back of the hall today, all detailed on your screen. And finally, just a reminder that we're still hosting our usual call to prayer on Tuesday and Friday mornings at 8 a.m. for the early birds. Okay, shall we pray? Father, we do just thank you for this wonderful weather that we're experiencing at the moment. Father, we just thank you for all your creation. And Father, we just remember that promise that you gave to us, that where two or three are gathered in your name, you will be there in the midst. And Father, we claim that promise today. We claim your presence here with us. Father, we just ask that we may just take on board everything that you have for us today. Father, that you will speak to us through your Holy Spirit as individuals and collectively. And Father, as we look at how to live together as your people, Father, just speak to us. Open our hearts and open our ears. And Father, may we leave this place, different people, transformed and ready to live together. So Father, we just thank you for this time. It is a privilege to be here. Many people struggle to have the freedom that we have to worship you. So Father, we just thank you for that. And we just look to worship you now in your name and for your glory. Amen.
Amen. Let's stand. Shout! Faithfulness.
Amazing. Thank you, guys. Let's give them another round of applause. That was fantastic. Brilliant. I can't wait till next week, because we can join them. Well, you might be joining them already. I don't know what you're doing behind those masks, but, you know, you can join them legally next week. And it's just going to be such a fantastic sound, isn't it? It's just going to be great to be able to sing again. Okay, so I'm going to invite Senga up now to give us our reading for the day.
Morning, everyone. The reading today is taken from 1 Thessalonians chapter 5. I'm going to read from verse 12 to verse 24, and I'm reading in the Message version of the Bible. And the heading in my Message Bible says, "The way he wants you to live." The way he wants you to live. And now, friends, we ask you to honour those leaders who work so hard for you, who have been given the responsibility of urging and guiding you along in your obedience. Overwhelm them with appreciation and love. Get along among yourselves, each of you doing your part. Our counsel is that you warn the freeloaders to get a move on. Gently encourage the stragglers and reach out for the exhausted, pulling them to their feet. Be patient with each person, attentive to individual needs, and be careful that when you get on each other's nerves, you don't snap at each other. Look for the best in each other. And always do your best to bring it out. Be cheerful no matter what. Pray all the time. Thank God no matter what happens. This is the way God wants you who belong to Christ Jesus to live. Don't suppress the Spirit and don't stifle those who have a word from the Master. But on the other hand, don't be gullible. Check out everything and keep only what's good. Throw out anything tainted with evil. May God Himself, the God who makes everything holy and whole, make you holy and whole. Put you together, spirit, soul, and body, and keep you fit for the coming of our Master Jesus Christ. The one who called you is completely dependable, and if he said it, he'll do it. God will bless his word, I'm sure.
Amen. Keith, I'm going to invite you up now, and I'm going to pray for you. Father, we just thank you for your servant, Keith. It's great to have him with us. And Father, we just pray that you will fill him with your spirit as he speaks to us. Speak to us through him. May he be your vessel. Father, we just thank you for his ministry and thank you for the way that he preaches your word. And Father, we just ask that you will, in the process of this sermon today, that you will speak to each one of us individually. You will speak to our hearts and you will speak to our minds. So Father, we just commit this sermon to your name. Amen.
Thanks, Ashley. Good morning, everybody. Good morning. I know you're not supposed to sing, but you can at least say good morning. Yeah. Good to see you. Good to be with you. In fact, it's a day of celebration. Look at that glorious, glorious weather. And I'm telling you, be thankful for where you are. Because we came up from Bournemouth this morning, and if you think this is stuffy, stuck in traffic jams that were 3, 4, 5 miles long going down to Bournemouth, I can tell you there were 3 lots of traffic jams. You do not want to be going down to the beach today. Far, far better to be in the house of God. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. So this morning we're continuing on in the theme in 1 Thessalonians, living lives that are worthy, living together as God's people. We heard last week of the hope that we have knowing that Jesus will return. Hallelujah, do I hear?
Amen.
Amen. And he's coming back to take his children with him. The challenge was how that will affect your life and my life today. And today we're looking at a continuation as Paul continues with the exhortation to make a difference. In the very beginning of that passage, he mentions the word brothers. In fact, it occurs 27 times in the first and the second book of Thessalonians. Why? Well, I believe that it was Paul's desire that people would recognize that we are a family. That is the whole purpose. He was introducing himself to a family, and he talked to brothers and sisters in that family. We are the members of the body of God. We are to grow, develop gifts, and serve God. Just like a biological family, the members are born into it. And so, in exactly the same way, we are born into the family of God. And it's meant to be a place where we all feel accepted and appreciated. Family, I want to deal it in three headings this morning. Living together as God's people, my principles, key principles to follow. The first one we're going to look at is family leadership, because we are dealing with the family of God as we're looking into it in the scriptures. The family leadership, verses 12 and 13. And verse 12 says, "And now, friends, we ask you to honor those leaders who work so hard for you, who have been given the responsibility of urging and guiding you along in your obedience. Excuse me. Overwhelm them with appreciation and love." That sounds a bit harsh. And you notice that word right at the very beginning, which says honor. What is honor? Honor is to show your respect or admiration for someone, especially by giving them a prize. Unfortunately, we can't revel in the fact of Wimbledon and the Euro 2020, because it didn't happen. They didn't get the prize. But we can still honor. In fact, I am appalled at the reaction that we've seen after the Euro 2020, the accusations and the media slurs that are going on, the abuse for some of the England team. We should be honoring them for having played out of their socks for the games that they did play in. It's sad that there is always somebody who wants to put somebody else down so that they feel better. Honor is worthy of receipt. But I want to see a different culture. I don't want to see the culture of the outside media situation appearing in the church. Don't we all want to see something different? The church puts on completely different persona. Well, hang on a minute, you might say. Oh, just a minute. You've got to be joking. You can't expect me to be honoring my leaders. Well, I mean, there might be inside you something saying, you know, there are certain things I need to get sorted out, because there are things that aren't working right. I have the right to say what I think. And that is the spirit of the age today. We have the right to say what we think. But sometimes we need to be wise and sensible about how we pass on comments in these ways. I mean, I have a right. And not only that, some will be thinking, but I own the staff. I own the paid workers because I'm giving my money to them to support their salary, and so I own them. Wrong. The money you have is all God's. God doesn't own the staff team. You don't own the staff team, sorry. God owns the staff team. And they are under the authority of God, and they are under the responsibility of God. Does that mean we don't say anything? Well, it's not exactly like that. But the leaders of this church, and particularly the paid staff, are leaders by their example and by their practical outworking of the way that they serve and minister in the church. And that is a very high standard to be held to. In fact, the scriptures we read there said, those who work so hard for you. Sometimes we think they should be doing a whole lot more, but actually they're working hard, very hard, on everyone's behalf in order to support the ministry of the church on a daily basis. And that is why all the more reason why we should be grateful for what is being done. I have to say we are always very pleased and encouraged when we see the way that you've announced the various activities that are going on in church. Food bank starting tomorrow. Isn't that a wonderful thing? Well-being starting in September. The training going on. These are things that we can rejoice in because the leadership are taking responsibility for making a difference in your life and mine and in the local community. And that is something to be grateful for, believe me. Now you might think, hang on, this guy is the dad of one of the staff team. He's been primed. He's already had a couple of hours of priming from the leaders to speak what they want to hear, what they think should be said. Absolute rubbish. I am talking now from somebody who is an individual in the house of God. And I believe that there is needs to be honor where honor is due. And we need to uplift those who are in service against us. Am I saying that therefore they're perfect? Good grief, no. They're all weak and feeble, just like you and me. They all have weaknesses. Listen, I've lived with Stuart for first 20 years of his life, and I know he's not perfect. I know he's got a load of weaknesses. But at the same time, he's got a heart to serve God. And that is something to rejoice in. And there are many leaders, as we look throughout the scriptures even, there are many leaders who were significant in leading the children of Israel, but they had times when they were weak and they were feeble and they failed. We look at Abraham, Moses, David, and Peter. These are all people who were significant in the house of God, but all had an element of weakness and failure. All of us, including the leaders, need to know God's correction and forgiveness. And you know, there might be an element in which sometimes they don't get it all right, but it's not about the right or wrong of it. It's the way you and I deal with it that is most important. If you have a grievance or recognize something is wrong, don't grumble away, don't moan to somebody else, don't gossip in the background, don't feed people who think you're on your side. Take the courage to stand by your convictions and take action to go and see them and speak to them. To an individual leader or the team of elders and present your humble concern. In love, not aggression. That is what my appeal to you is. They are serving you, they are seeking to work on your behalf. Do them the honorable thing by endeavoring to enable them to do it in love, with correction as appropriate. I want to ask you, when did you last go to one of the leaders and thank them for doing a good job and helping in so many ways to help us all to grow to be more like Jesus? When was the last time that you actually went and said thank you to somebody? It's not always an easy thing and we brush it off. But you see, there is no limit to what can be accomplished if it doesn't matter who gets the credit. There is a whole lot that can be achieved in church if we have the spirit of encouragement and honor in order to support and encourage those who serve us. It's sometimes a totally thankless task. I know I've been in leadership in the past. But it's such an encouragement when we receive a word of thanks or a word of support at times when things are really a struggle. There is no limit to what can be accomplished if it doesn't matter who gets the credit. Let's honor each other. Let's bless each other. Let's lift each other up rather than seek to push down and discourage. So there's family leadership, but there's also family partnership. In recent years, the church has rediscovered the truth of body life. The whole aspect in the church with the pressures of life, we often resort to the default that everything is done by the pastors and elders. I know that there are a lot of pressures in life today. Often both husband and wife are working, both partners are working, and that gives pressure. And so we tend to sit back and relax, and our default is to allow, say to them, well, they're being paid or whatever, they should be doing the work. Actually, God has called us all to be functioning. And that's why I've got the picture up there of the body, because it's body life. Every aspect, every organ, every limb, every part of the body is so valuable in order to function as a proper organism that achieves what God wants it to do. The reality is we all serve each other, just like every member of the body serves the other members. The scripture we read said this: get along among yourselves, each of you doing your part. The question I asked this morning is, are you functioning as a member of that church, of that body? Our counsel is that you warn the freeloaders to get a move on. Gently encourage the stragglers and reach out for the exhausted, pulling them to their feet. Be patient with each person, attentive to individual needs, and be careful that when you get on each other's nerves, you don't snap at each other. Look for the best in each other and always do your best to bring it out. I almost want to read that again, because it takes a while for that all to sink in, because there's a lot of exhortations to us. In fact, I will read it. Get along among yourselves, each of you doing your part. Can I ask you right now to be humble before God and say, Lord, am I actually doing what I'm supposed to be doing? Our counsel is that you warn the freeloaders to get a move on. Gently encourage the stragglers. Did you go alongside somebody who was struggling to come to church and say, I'll give you a hand, I'll give you a lift or support you in that situation? Reach out for the exhausted, pulling them to their feet. Be patient with each person. Whoa, that's a bit of a challenge. But God has asked us that we do this. We should be attentive to individual needs. And be careful that when you get on each other's nerves, you don't snap at each other. Look for the best in each other and always do your best to bring it out. The body is a wonderful illustration of how we in the church should act and react to each other. In fact, in another scripture, 1 Corinthians 12, verses 25-26, they say, the way God designed our bodies is a model for understanding our lives together as a church. Every part dependent on every other part. The parts we mention and the parts we don't. The parts we see and the parts that we don't. If one part hurts, every other part is involved in the hurt and in the healing. If one part flourishes, every other part enters into the exuberance. That is the reality of body life in the church, the family of God. We can celebrate together, we can ache together with the things that we all struggle with. We're all struggling with COVID right now. We're looking forward to tomorrow when things are changing. But actually, there are still going to be restrictions. There's still going to be an aspect of apprehension and fear. But we can pull together, we can encourage one another, we can stand and show that actually, as people of God who have somewhere that we know we're going to, well, this is not our home. Let's remind ourselves, let's remind each other, this is not our home. We're only traveling through. We're on going to somewhere far, far better, which is going to allow all these things, all these negatives, to drift away. Yes, ultimately, we want to see a church that has a spirit that says, I appreciate you. What it means and why it's important. It's important because we need to support and encourage. Jesus did that to the people he met every day of his life here on earth. And that should be an example and a model for each one of us in our lives today. So the body works together. Even though we might not feel as a significant person within the church, you are significant. I want to say right now, I appreciate you came along this morning to hear me. I'm surprised. But it's an encouragement to know you're here and some of you are listening. But I believe that we can encourage and support each other. We can help each other to know the better way to live. We can understand the better way to honor God and to serve him and praise him, to be able to work together and to support each other and to enable God's mission to the people around this church to know who Jesus Christ is. Body life is not always easy. If you're anything like me, you're beginning to realize that things start to go wrong with the body. I'm getting older in my life, and in fact, just 10 days ago, I went to the doc because I had a bit of a tremble. And I said, well, what do you think it is? And he did me the once over, worked over, and I've just had the initial diagnosis of Parkinson's back 10 days ago. So my hand starts to tremble every so often. What am I going to do? Grab hold of it or take it off, cut it off, say, well, you're a waste of time. You're causing me more trouble than it's worth. I'll cut it off, get rid of it. Is that a useful answer? I want to suggest it's not. I'm now learning for one hand to tell the other hand to do something, to stop it shaking. It has to do something. It's got to be something positive that it is able to do. Because then the trembling stops. So I've got to learn how to adjust to the new changes that are happening in my body. These are things that happen in each one of us. We don't know quite what God is doing all the time. But let us be aware that he's teaching us on a daily basis what it is to appreciate and love each other. We are a family that needs to appreciate and love each other. When was the last time you went up to somebody and thanked them for who they are and what they do? I want to ask whether you've said it to any of the leaders of the church, perhaps to the band. Thanks, Matt and McCaclear. The tech team. Well done. Thank you very much. What about the Sunday school and youth leaders? Yes, we managed to get rid of our kids into there, but what about going up to the leaders who have them every week and saying, thank you so much, you've done a great job, you're helping my kids to know who Jesus is. When did you last say something to them to thank them for it? What about the cleaners of the church? It's all hidden, it's never seen, but that's a vital job, particularly in the light of COVID and all that's going on. The welcome team, who come here early, get here early and make sure everything's ready. Or maybe just somebody. Just maybe you went and thanked somebody for smiling because they brought a smile of Jesus to you that day. May we have a spirit of thankfulness because God has made the difference in our lives. We all function better. Well, I don't know about you, but I certainly do. I function a lot better when I get a little bit of encouragement. So let us be people of encouraging, people who say the words, not just think them, just come here to church and go out the door again. Stop and ask yourself, who deserves a little bit of a thank you and an encouragement this morning before I head off home? I want to also say, what about saying to the families, bless you for the little babies. I love it when the babies are in the service. You're doing a great job. Well done. May God help you to raise those children to be men and women of God who make a difference in this church in the future. Amen. Amen? It doesn't take much, but what a difference it can make. And let's pray that the God fills them with his spirit, that they might be empowered to do what's right for the children that they've brought up. Family leadership, family partnership, and family worship. We're called to true worship. Yes, on an individual basis, but we're called to true worship together. Thank God for Buckskin Church that makes it possible to come regularly and share together and be part of a family. Because Jesus is worthy of our praise and Father God is to be honored. What are the characteristics of this family worship? Well, when we read in verses 16 and 70, first of all, it was an attitude of thankfulness. I'm wondering, did we come with an attitude of thankfulness this morning? Were we ready to say, Lord, I want to come, I want to sing. Yeah, I know there's a restriction, but in my heart, I want to sing and give you the thanks and praise. This last 18 months has been a nightmare, and there's no telling what the future holds, but we have one who holds the future. And so we can come with thankfulness to know that we are able to meet together, and one day we'll be with Jesus. We think of Alan, who recently went to be with his Lord, and he's now glorifying God in heaven with Jesus, and we'll be joining him. It's an attitude of thankfulness, it's an attitude of prayer, and it's an attitude of praise. May our hearts be filled with these characteristics as we come into the house of God and as we share with each other the ministry that he has. And it's not only just those, but it's also verses 18 to 22 clearly say that we need to establish the word of God to be the hallmark of whatever we do. Again, I would say thank you to the team who've devised the teaching series and those who are active in ministering on a Sunday morning, because it enables us to understand something more of what God is trying to say to us in our lives and to help us to grow and develop. The word of God should be the hallmark. The church family worship is not to be, dare I say it, entertainment or theatrical production. One of the problems we're seeing now in some churches is that it's all following the spirit of the society we're in, and everything is an entertainment value and a theatrical production, and we all get hyped up. But what about tomorrow? May our worship, may our getting together be an opportunity to grow and develop and be able to know that God is working. And in part of that, it says clearly, let the Holy Spirit in these verses do the talking. Don't stifle the freedom. We should all be actively asking God, what is my gift in the church? What is my opportunity to share and to give? No matter what, from just saying thank you to somebody or perhaps preaching, whatever it is, through every spectrum of church life, we have the opportunity. And we give the opportunity to all who have a gifting. Again, that's honoring those who have been gifted by God in certain areas. Maybe I don't know whether you know what your gifting is. Maybe you need to go and speak to one of the leaders and say, can you help me to find out what my gifting is so I can be an active member? As I was saying with my hands, you need to find something that makes you active and involved and honorable within the church. Don't despise prophecy, the scripture clearly says. Don't despise prophecy. It's a valuable tool in hearing God in what he's saying. And again, that is honoring the people who are gifted within the church. It's always to be checked against the word of God. That is our standard. That is our plumb line for everything that we have within the church. And that should be how it works. All with the enabling of the Holy Spirit. And I'm praying that Buckskin may know of an outflow of the Holy Spirit of God, that he might work through you, every single one of you, from the youngest to the very oldest, that there might be a dynamic outpouring of the Spirit of God to touch lives, both inside the church, but also outside the church. That you might become a beacon and a light far greater than you've ever been before, because you're actively honoring each other and you're actively looking to be your part that serves within the church of God. Tomorrow, the 19th, Hallelujah? Well, up to a point. I'm already hearing people saying, maybe we still need to keep masks on. But at least we can sing. Are you not looking forward to next week when you can sing? Whoop, whoop, Emma is, definitely. We can meet without face masks. We can sing worship with all our hearts. Even give each other a big hug. Things that we've been missing for so long. There is still an element of concern in the background of each one of us. But let us come, and can I ask the band if they would come up now? Let us come together as the family of God. Let us be people who recognize that we each have value in the body of Christ. We each have a function and a part to play. Everyone is important. And those that don't seem to take much part or seem to be significant, let's go up and honor them, thank them, bless them, and give them the appreciation. We all need the encouragement that God can give us through each other for his glory. Church is about partnership. That's the word we've been hearing. So let us take the opportunity to meet together, leaving our comfortable, dare I say it, next week we have the opportunity to do church like we've always normally done. Perhaps there is a call to some who have got used to sitting in the couch and watching the online. I want to encourage everyone to be together that we can serve and honor and worship Jesus Christ and our Father God as we unite together, and so that God gets the glory and we are all blessed together. Can I ask you, do something to bless somebody today? To honor them, to give them the respect that it is due. And I know that Buckskin Church will be a far, far better place, and God will honor it. I close with that last verse. May God himself, the God who makes everything holy and whole, make you holy and whole, put you together, spirit, soul, and body, and keep you fit for the coming of the Master Jesus Christ. The one who called you is completely dependable. Hallelujah. If we put our total trust in God and in the Lord Jesus Christ, we know that we can receive blessing. And if God said it, he will do it. Praise his name. And may it be to the glory of his name. Amen. Thank you.
Shall we stand? And we can come together and we can worship as one body, one church, one family.
Of God is stricken, then see his foe.
I think of myself as a server, as a doer. I'm not really a front of the church guy, I'm the background guy. And it's just, you know, it's just so amazing how God gives us all different gifts. You know, some of us are noses, sniff out the things that are going on in the church. Some of us are ears, that's definitely not me. Some of us are, you know, all the different parts of the body, and together we do have the chance to make such a difference. Such a difference. And yeah. So I'm going to close in prayer in a minute. So that's it for this morning. Thank you to those that have joined us online. Those of you that are here today, we just pray that you all enjoy the rest of your day and that you have a blessed week. So I'm going to close now in prayer. Father, we thank you for the hope that we have in you. Father, that you are returning and we will be going with you. And Father, we thank you in the meantime for the exhortation that we have to make a difference. A difference as a family, a difference individually, but more than that, a difference as part of the body of God. And Father, just help us as we go through each day to recognize and honor each other. Give us that heart to serve. Show us what our gifts are so that we can become that body that you want us to be. We're each different. We're all different parts. But Father, we just pray that you will help us to appreciate each other, that you will give us the strength. And Father, just remember, we just remember that you take weak people. You don't take strong, perfect people. We look at all the people in the Bible that you've used, and they're all people that you recognize weaknesses in, but took them and made them strong. So Father, just take each one of us in our weakness and make us what you want us to be, so that we can be the family and the body that does make a difference. We ask all these things in your name and for your glory. Amen. So thank you very much, everybody. If you're in the building still, we would love to pray.